Our text for this morning is taken from the Holy Gospel, as just read by Pastor, Luke chapter 7, verses 1 through 10. In the name of Jesus, amen. I want you guys to think about a man driving down the street who crashes his car into a restaurant window. Now, the man didn't hurt anybody, but he did a lot of damage to that restaurant and scared a lot of people. Now, let us say that this man finds himself going to court and there runs into someone who was sitting in that restaurant that day. And that man comes up to him and says, "I forgive you for crashing into that restaurant." Now, I'm sure the man who was driving the car appreciates knowing that he is forgiven by this diner. But he still has to pay for the damages he did to that restaurant. The diner does not have the authority to forgive the man for the property damage he caused. However, if later that day in court, that man goes to the judge, and the judge says, "I have already paid all the damages, and I forgive you," then that man is truly forgiven and free, because the judge has the authority to forgive. He was given that authority by the U.S. government, which he serves. In a way, this judge is like Jesus, who has come under the authority of God the Father to save the children of Abraham. Now, in today's gospel reading, we meet a centurion, and like Jesus, and like the judge, he is a man set under authority. He tells Jesus, "For I too am a man set under authority, with soldiers under me, and I say to one, 'Go,' and he goes, and to another, 'Come,' and he comes, and to my servant, 'Do this,' and he does it." In the first century, a Roman centurion was indeed a powerful man with great authority. The life of every Roman soldier in the Roman army belonged to a centurion. It was the job of the centurion to make sure that the soldiers stayed in line, which often was done through beatings or even executions. But the centurion was also a leader of soldiers who led from the front. He would charge into battle with his soldiers on the front line, and he could become quite wealthy. A Roman centurion could easily make 17 times the amount that the average Roman citizen would in a year. Because of all of this, his authority, his leadership, and his wealth, a Roman centurion was a very well-respected member of Roman society. The centurion in today's gospel lesson is not bragging to Jesus about his authority, but he is speaking honestly about it and where his authority comes from. He says, "For I too am a man set under authority, with soldiers under me." The centurion realizes that he only has authority because it has been given to him by those who are above him. The centurion has received his authority from the general above him, who in turn has received his authority from the emperor above him. The centurion holds the power of life and death over all his soldiers because he is set under the authority of the man who ultimately has all the power in the Roman Empire. So when this Roman centurion remarks that Jesus, too, is a man under authority, this is actually a confession of great faith. He is acknowledging Jesus as an equal, as a peer, and actually as a superior to himself. He says, "I, too, am a man set under authority." This Gentile centurion is the first person in the Gospel of Luke to recognize Jesus' identity as a man set under authority. The centurion sends his friends to Jesus, saying, "Lord, Do not trouble yourself, for I am not worthy to have you come under my roof. Therefore, I did not presume to come to you, but say the word, and let my servant be healed. The centurion recognizes that Jesus has the authority to heal his servant with a word. He realizes that he received this authority from God the Father. The centurion may have received his authority from the emperor, but Jesus has received his authority from God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. And it is because of this almighty source of power that the centurion acknowledges Jesus' superiority to himself and realizes that Jesus, with a single word, can heal his servant. And the centurion is right about Jesus. Jesus is a man set under authority. As the angel Gabriel testified to Mary before Jesus' birth, saying, "He will be called the Holy One, the Son of God." Jesus is the Christ, the Anointed One. As Jesus himself says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me." He was anointed for kingship, to be a prophet and speak for God, and he was anointed to be our high priest. He was anointed for all of these things in his baptism, where the Holy Spirit descended upon him and the Father proclaimed, "You are my beloved Son. With you I am well pleased." Through his miracles, his death, and his resurrection, Jesus proves that he has conquered sin, death, and the devil, and that his statement is true when he says, "All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me." Jesus is the eternal Son of God, who from before the very foundation of the earth received this authority. The Apostle Paul says in his epistle to the Colossians, "For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. All things were created through him and for him." This is how great of an authority Jesus has been given. All things were created through him and for him. The centurion has been given authority by the emperor to complete the mission given to him by the emperor. Jesus has been given authority by God the Father to complete his mission, to save the children of Abraham from their bondage to sin and death. For every human being is born sinful and selfish. Ever since the rebellion of our first parents, Adam and Eve, we have continued in our rebellion against the God who has created us. Even those who claim to be followers of God rebel against him. The Pharisees and Sadducees, who were the pastors and professors of their day, believed that they were shoo-ins for the kingdom of God. They thought that they would make it in because of their righteous deeds. But throughout Jesus' ministry, he shows them again and again that they may appear holy to the world, but that God sees through their hypocrisy, that they are without love. The Pharisees and Sadducees thought that they were the righteous children of Abraham, but John the Baptist rebukes them, saying, "Do not begin to say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our father.' For I tell you, God is able from these stones to raise up children for Abraham." He warns them that even those who appear holy need to repent. He says this by saying, "Bear good fruits in keeping with repentance." There are many in the church today who appear holy but need to repent. Whether it be the televangelist or even the local parish pastor who twists the word of God, yet clothes himself in a veneer of righteousness and churchliness? Or whether it is the politician who uses the name of God and prays before crowds to gain votes and trust? Or even the aunt who uses the Bible as a bludgeon to shame her family into doing what she wants? Because of this, Jesus has been set under the authority of God the Father in order to save the children of Abraham. But we need to ask ourselves, who are the children of Abraham? The Pharisees and Sadducees thought that they were the children of Abraham. They thought that the children of Abraham were the biological descendants of Abraham. But again, John the Baptist rebukes them, saying, "Do not begin to say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our father.' For I tell you, God is able from these stones to raise up children for Abraham. No, the children of Abraham are those who bear good fruit in keeping with repentance, as John the Baptist says. But what is that good fruit? It is contrition for sins and faith in the promises of God." Ironically, this Roman Gentile was a true child of Abraham, the Hebrew patriarch. Obviously, not because of his lineage, but because of his repentance. He does not even presume himself to be worthy to approach Jesus. He says, "Lord, do not trouble yourself, for I am not worthy to have you come under my roof. Therefore, I did not presume to come to you." In his words, he shows the repentance that is in his heart. On the other hand, the Jewish elders do not quite understand repentance. They come to Jesus on behalf of the centurion, saying, "He is worthy to have you do this for him, for he loves our nation, and he is the one who built our synagogue." They say that the centurion deserves Jesus' aid because of the good works he did for the community. Yet the centurion does not have the same confidence in his works. The centurion knows that he is not righteous. The Jewish elders say, "He is worthy to have you do this for him," but he says, "I am not worthy." The centurion, a Roman Gentile, is also a child of Abraham on account of his faith in Jesus Christ. The Apostle Paul tells us that Abraham is the father of all the faithful, and that includes the Gentiles. Like the centurion, who is a Gentile, he is the first, as I have mentioned, to recognize that Jesus is a man set under the authority of the Father. And he trusts in the fact that Jesus has the authority to heal his servant with a single word. Most importantly, he trusts not only that Jesus could heal his servant, but he trusts that Jesus will heal his servant. He trusts in the mercy and the authority of Jesus Christ. This shows his faith. If we have any doubt about his faith, we can just look to the words of Jesus himself, who says, "When Jesus heard these things, he marveled at him, and turning to the crowd that followed him, said, 'I tell you, not even in Israel have I found such faith.'" How did this centurion receive such faith? How did he know that Jesus could heal his servant? And how did he know that Jesus would heal his servant? It is in the same way that faith is always given. Luke tells us the centurion heard about Jesus. That is, the centurion heard about Jesus' teachings and he heard about Jesus' deeds, and he believed. The Holy Spirit is always working through the Word of God to create faith. The centurion heard about Jesus' deeds, and the Holy Spirit, through the Holy Spirit, knew that Jesus was from God and that he would be merciful to him despite his unworthiness. The faith of the centurion is a miracle worked in him by the Holy Spirit. Again, listen to the words of Jesus. When Jesus heard these things, he marveled at him, and turning to the crowd that followed him, said, "I tell you, not even in Israel have I found such faith." Jesus marveled at his faith. The Greek word used here for marveled is athalmasin. This word, athalmasin, is usually used as the reaction of the crowds to Jesus' miracles. When the crowds see the mighty works of God done through Jesus in his miracles, they marvel. They athalmasin. In the same way, Jesus marvels at the miracle of faith worked in the Roman centurion by God the Holy Spirit. Just like Jesus works the miracle of salvation on the cross, the Holy Spirit works the miracle of faith through the Word of God. Jesus has come under the authority of God the Father to save the children of Abraham. The centurion is truly a child of Abraham, and you too are children of Abraham. The centurion shows this in his contrition for sins and his faith in God's promises. He shows his trust in Jesus Christ, that Jesus has the authority to save his spirit, servant, and will. You too are children of Abraham. You have heard the mighty works that Jesus has done. During Advent, you heard that God would send his Son to save the world. During Christmas, you heard that God was born in the flesh. During Lent, you heard how Jesus Christ, the righteous one, suffered. During Good Friday, you heard how he was crucified for you, for your sins. And on Easter, you heard how he rose from the dead. All these things he did to save us, to save you from sin, death, and the devil. Also, like the centurion, you know that what Jesus did was for you. In your baptism, Jesus singled you out as a recipient of his promise by pouring the water over your head. In the Lord's Supper, the Holy Spirit reveals to you that Jesus' death on the cross was for you. It reveals that his body is broken for you, that his blood was shed for you, that very same body and that very same blood is given for your forgiveness, for the remission of sins. Jesus has come under the authority of the Father to save us. Amen.